I think we are off to a great start. Martijn, please tell us more about electronic convergence.
Yes, well, before we get to that, I still have to finish up the my talk about the PRW method. So where I showed that with every semi-local operator A, we can associate a pseudo PRW operator such that the expectation value of this operator A can be written as the expectation value of the operator A tilde, the PRW operator, with respect to these PRW pseudo orbitals. So, and mind, these pseudo orbitals are the ones on the plane wave grid. And as an example, I showed that for the density. So we have a part of the density represented on the plane wave grid, and then we have two terms that that live in these PRW spheres and that are represented on radial logarithmic grids. So, and there's an all electron term and a pseudized term as well. So that is the case for any semi-local operator A. And let's not forget one point that was, that was mentioned here. Okay, it doesn't want to. Yep. And assuming completeness of the one center basis. So that is a not unimportant point, but we assume that our one center basis is complete enough to guarantee this. So non-local operators are more complicated, it's written here, and that is true. So the pseudo orbitals, the ones on the plane wave grid, they do not have the same norm as the the pseudo orbitals, the pseudo partial waves, should have written here, do not have the same norm as the all electron partial waves inside the PRW spheres. And to correctly this, the same goes, the same also goes for the pseudo orbital on the plane wave grid, by the way. It does not have the correct norm. It's not a norm conserving method, the PRW method. And that is a problem because to correctly describe long range electrostatic interactions between the spheres, that would be necessary. Let's start with this picture on the plane wave grid. So this would be the portion of space where this where one of the spheres sits, and this is another portion of space. Now, if the charge on the plane wave grid inside of this area is not correct, if the moments the first, second, and so on moments of this charge density inside the sphere are not correct, then the potential, the electrostatic potential outside of it, that is cast by this density outside of the sphere, is not correct either, right? So as soon as the local moments are correct, however, then the inside the sphere, then the potential outside the sphere is correct. So that means that to have the correct interaction between what is happening here onto what is happening around it, the moments of the charge density inside the sphere have to be correct, and they are not, because not even the norm is conserved, right? So to correct this, to correctly describe long-range electrostatic interactions between the PRW spheres and between the density inside the spheres and the density in the interstitial, we add a compensation charge into the spheres. And this compensation charge repairs for the fact that the norm and several higher moments of the charge density inside of these spheres are not correct. So that is done on the plane wave grid, and it's written here. So we call this the compensation charge, and it is written here as rho hat. So this all happens on the plane wave grid, what you see here. So inside this area where these spheres would sit, we add something that repairs the charge density in this particular area. And it has to be soft. And soft in this means it has to be representable on this plane wave grid. So it may not have too many high frequency variations, because otherwise it would become very expensive to represent it on this plane wave grid. So we choose shapes for that and that are soft enough and so on and so forth. And these things are defined on the podcast files as well. And then we repair the charge density in this inside these spheres. So now the interaction of the potential that is cast by what is happening in the sphere with whatever happens outside of it is correct. Of course, adding something inside the sphere means that what happens inside the sphere, we have an additional density that interacts with other stuff inside the sphere that's incorrect. So we have to subtract that. And to do that, we essentially add the same thing inside the spheres in this pseudo term. Yeah? So in the thing that is subtracted out. So what is left is, of course, what happens from one sphere to the next, because whatever we subtract in this part is only limited to within its own sphere. So what we do here does not affect the interaction of this with that particular thing, with that particular sphere. So we add compensation charges on the plane wave grid, and we subtract the same charges in this pseudized one center description inside of the spheres. And then, of course, this remains unchanged. So in the end, essentially, we have achieved the same reconstruction as before. Again, we have written our, in this case, non-local operator, the Hartree energy. We have again written this in three parts and in the same three parts. So one strictly on the plane wave grid, one inside a pseudized one inside of the VRW spheres, and an all electron counterpart inside of this VRW spheres. And of course, when one goes to even more complicated non-local operators, like, I don't know, FOC exchange or whatever, this becomes more and more complicated, but it's the things that one has to do to cast all these operators within the PRW form. Yeah. So let's recap. So as I said, the same three-way decomposition now holds actually for the complete total energy. So I showed you this for all local operators and for the non-local operator that we have, which is the Hartree potential. We can separate the total energy in three contributions. One that is evaluated strictly on the plane wave grid, and one pseudized version inside PRW spheres, and an all electron one inside PRW spheres. And this one, the pseudized one center contributions are written in terms of these pseudo partial waves and compensation charges, and the all-electron counterpart, all-electron one-center contributions are written in terms of these all-electron partial waves. And there's no compensation charge in that particular case. So what do we have on the plane wave grid? We have our orbitals, we have a density, we have compensation charges, and what I see is missing here, we have the projector functions. They are also on the plane wave grid. And then we have on the atom-centered radial logarithmic grids, we have all electron partial waves and pseudo partial waves, and a version of the compensation charges as well. And these atom-centered radial terms, these one-center contributions, atom-centered represented on radial logarithmic grids, they add these nodal features near the cores, and they ensure the orthogonality between core and valence states, and so on. And the essence of the PRW method that apart from these projector functions, there are no cross terms between the quantities on the regular grid and the quantities on the radial grid. So, and these pseudo orbitals expressed in plane waves, they are the self-consistent solutions of this particular equation. And so our Cohn-Sham equation now looks like this. So additional terms have arisen. You already saw this equation, but there it was strictly for the atomic problem. This is now the equation that we are going to solve. And that is the task of WASP in that case. So this is the Cohn-Sham, this is the PLW form of the Cohn-Sham equations, where we now recognize two additional terms. Those are the ones that involve these PLW strength parameters, like I said before, and these augmentation charges. And they are computed from the partial wave. So this is essentially completely pre-computed. And these strength parameters, they depend on the one electron, on the one center density inside of the spheres. So they have to be essentially recomputed as we are computing our solutions. Yeah, so you see that here. So why do they vary? They vary because these one center occupancies, as we call them, that are computed out of these projections, they will vary as psi tilde changes, because psi tilde is our variational quantity. It's the thing that we have to determine to solve this particular equation. Yeah, so this is a graph that is supposed to convince you of the fact that the PLW method is very accurate. So it is compared here to an all electron method, the FLAPW method, which we sort of consider to be our gold standard in terms of accuracy for DFT calculations. And this particular publication, Kurt Liagere, did a very detailed analysis of the accuracy of our pseudo potentials, our PLW potentials, by comparing it with FLAPW calculations. And we see here that, so what is the measure? The measure is an energy versus volume curve for one code, let's say FLAP, and another code, let's say VASP PLW, and the area that you see here in gray, this is a measure for the discrepancy that one finds, and that is essentially the average of that is something like a 0.4 of a milliev per atom. So this is very, very, very good. Similar comparisons we have made by comparing to local basis set methods. So this is a comparison between Gaussian and WASP at the PBE level for a whole bunch of molecules, essentially for the atomization energy of a whole bunch of molecules. And what one sees is that the norm of the error that one makes, or the discrepancy that one finds in the atomization energy, is below a kcal per mole. And this is done for a PBE and for a hybrid functional here. And that basically shows, so one kcal per mole, you might store that in memory. That is chemical accuracy. So that is the kind of accuracy at which we would like to be able to compute energy differences, because that is the kind of accuracy that is reachable in experiment. And we see that these discrepancies are below one kcal per mole, but not for the comparison between experiment and computation, but for the comparison between two calculations. So this PLW method is very accurate. So now we came a very long way. We came we started with the many-body Schrödinger equation and said it was completely intractable. Then we introduced DFT, a map onto a one-electron method that already helped a bit. Then we invoked translational invariance that already helped a lot. Then came the PLW method. Then we introduced our plane wave basis set and said that it was so great, but unfortunately we can still not do a lot with it because it's too expensive. Then we introduced a pseudo-potential method, in this case the PW method, and now we are at the point that we say, okay, we have everything set, all ingredients are there, we can calculate we can solve our equations and calculate the electronic ground state of our material. But of course, we have not said yet how we are going to do that. How are we going to solve these equations? So, and basically there are two broad categories, methods, how to compute or how to reach the ground states, how to minimize the electronic degrees of freedom in such a way that you end up in the ground state. So the first we will call direct minimization of the DFT functional. So we have a functional and we can start with the set of orbitals and minimize the total energy by propagating the orbitals along the gradient. Now, if I take the gradient of my total energy expression, with respect to the orbitals, I essentially end up with these Kohn-Chung equations. So that is why this gradient looks so much, why you recognize essentially the Kohn-Chung equation inside this gradient. Yeah. And so here we have Hamiltonian, here we have this eigenvalue. And this is gradient, the derivative of the DFT total energy functional with respect to the orbital. And we could follow this gradient to a minimum by conjugate gradient optimization by whatever method of choice, but follow the gradient to the minimum. And that is what we will call direct minimization. And there's another way of doing that, of reaching the ground state, and that is the so-called self-consistency cycle. Here we start with trial orbitals and minimize the energy directly by changing the orbitals. Here we do it slightly differently. We start with the trial density. Our Hamiltonian is defined as a functional of the density. So we can start with trial density. In most cases, that is overlapping atomic charge densities. Because on these podcast files, we have all kinds of properties that were pre-calculated for the atoms. And one of them is their ground state charge density. And so we can construct an overlapping density of overlapping atomic charge densities and use that to start our self-consistency cycle. So we have a density, a trial density, construct the corresponding Hamiltonian, and then solve that Hamiltonian and obtain a set of orbitals. And these orbitals then define a new density that defines a new Hamiltonian, and then you iterate that to self-consistency. So the self-consistency cycle was at some point in time considered to be outmoded, as outdated, yes. And direct minimization was really the thing. That was in the time that Carr and Parinello did their groundbreaking work. So these Carr-Parinello methods, they are essentially direct minimization methods. But it can be shown that this old way of doing things, this self-consistency cycle, has some very distinct advantages over using direct minimization. And that is one of the key things that one of the things that was shown in one of the early papers, early publications of VASP, basically defining publications of VASP. And that is what you see here. Basically, what you see here is how many iterations it takes to converge the total energy or the forces. But let's stick to the upper part, the total energy, by means of the self-consistency cycle that is in this these lines, or by means of a direct minimization method. For a disordered diamond cell, an elongated disordered diamond cell of 1, 2, 4, and 8 unit cells. And we see that self-consistency cycle clearly wins out in this case. Then we go to a much more problematic system than this ordered diamond, and I will tell you why this is much more problematic, and that is disordered iron, so a metal. This is an insulator, this is a metal. And there we really see why the self-consistency cycle has advantages. We see that we are able to converge in all cases, and it takes a bit more iterations than in case of this insulator, this metallic system. But we are able to converge all cases, the total energy in all cases, also for the longest disordered cell. And we see that the direct minimization really greatly suffers in this case. And so for n is 8, for 8 repetitions of this unit cell, we do not find a self-consistent solution at all using this direct method. So why does this happen? And I will also tell you why this is still relevant for you in your work. So this happens because of charge sloshing. So if we look at the gradient of the total energy with respect to an orbital, so that's the thing that I showed you before in direct minimization, but let's look at this gradient in a slightly different representation, then we see that the gradient consists essentially of two parts. So it consists of a part at any point of your calculation, you have a set of orbitals that you are optimizing, right? So this particular set that you have at that time, they define a subspace. So there is a part of the gradient that lives inside of the particular subspace that is shown here. And so these are the orbitals you are essentially still optimizing, the ones that you have, your current solution, if you so want, they define a part of the gradient inside of this space spent by these orbitals, and there's a part that points outside of this particular subspace. Now, the point that points outside of this particular subspace, and that's what you see here, so this is basically a projection of your upon your subspace that is subtracted out. So this part that that points outside is not so problematic, but this particular part, so, and that means that there's a part of the gradient that makes linear combinations of the orbitals that you currently have. That particular part is problematic. And especially in the case of metallic systems, this is so. Because if you would consider a metal or something with a strongly elongated cell, and you have states that are close below the Fermi energy and states that are slightly above the Fermi energy, and you have occupied and unoccupied states that are close together, this will make linear combinations of the states that are below the Fermi energy with states that are above the Fermi energy. So if we consider two states, one slightly below the Fermi energy and one slightly above, then a small subspace rotation will change these states in such a way that that they will lead to a change in the density of this nature. So I have something slightly below the Fermi, below K Fermi by a small vector delta K, and I will get a change in the density that has a period of something like 2 times delta K. And unfortunately, such a long wavelength change in the density will cause a very strong change in the electrostatic potential, because it enters with 1/2 delta K squared in the change in the Hartree potential. And this will make the system unstable unless I follow this gradient with very small time steps. So that is essentially a big problem in computing the ground state, especially for metallic systems, is this discharge sloshing. And that is a point where the self-consistency cycle And there's ways to deal with this in the self-consistency cycle that are ways around this problem with the charge solution. So, and I will show you that in a minute, how that works. But let's first look at the ingredients of the self-consistency cycle, if you so want. So like I said, there's a trial charge that we construct basically out of atomic overlapping atomic charge densities. Of course, we have to initialize our orbitals in some way. Mostly this is done with random numbers simply. And then for this atomic charges, for this charge density of overlapping atomic charges, we set up a Hamiltonian, and then we start refining our wave functions. So I will get to that point, but this is a key element in our self-consistency cycle, is that we do iterative diagonalization here. We'll come to that. So we start out with these guys, they are random numbers. So of course they cannot remain random numbers. We set up a Hamiltonian and we start to compute orbitals that are consistent with this Hamiltonian, if you so want. So that will do for a while, which is not completely up till a perfect solution for these orbitals, because these orbitals will, generally speaking, define a new charge density that is different from the charge density that we came in with, right? So we get a new charge density from after a while of iteratively refining these wave functions, we get a new charge density, and then we do not simply plug that new charge density into the and compute a new Hamiltonian out of this new charge density. No, we do a refinement of the density, or we do so-called what we call density mixing. Basically, it means we take a big part of what of the previous density and only add a small part of the new density, and that stabilizes this algorithm. And that basically is also why we are not so troubled by charge loss, because we do not accept, we do not simply accept this new density. So this density mixing will get us around this charge loss in the self-consistency cycle. So two key ingredients. One is iterative diagonalization. And you might have, if you're already working with WASP, you will have seen things like residual minimization due to diagonalization of the iterative subspace, or the Bloch-Davidson method. Those are iterative diagonalizers, and I will come to that. And the other ingredient is density mixing, and what we use is a Broyden mixer. So essentially, we iterate this until the total energy doesn't change anymore, or at least changes fall below a certain cutoff criterion that the user chooses. After that, after self-consistency has been reached, so the Hamiltonian that you get for a certain density leads to wave functions that yield essentially the same density. After that particular self-consistency has been reached, one can calculate forces and do all kinds of things, relax the structure, do molecular dynamics, and so on and so forth. So let's look at this iterative diagonalization. So what would be the naive way, if I have a Hamiltonian, what would be the naive way to get wave functions? And to get this one electron orbitals? Well, the naive way would be to simply express my Hamiltonian, my Hamilton matrix in my plane wave basis set. So I can, write my Hamilton matrix like this, so I express it in my plane wave basis set and simply diagonalize this. What I will get will be eigenfunctions and eigenenergies from this diagonalization. How many will I get? Well, as many as I have basis functions. So as many as I have plane waves in my basis set, I will get, FFT, no, plane waves in my basis set, as many as I have those, I will get eigenfunctions and eigenenergies. Okay, that one can do, and then those eigenfunctions will give me a new density, and that will give me a new Hamiltonian that I can diagonalize, and so on and so forth, and I can do this until the density doesn't change anymore. Now, the problem with that is, that looks deceptively simple, but the problem with it is that that we do not need so many eigenfunctions of the Hamiltonian, right? We remember that for at every Bloch vector, we only need n, this was this band index, we only need n solutions of our Cohn-Sham equations at a particular Bloch wave vector, where n is of the order of the number of electrons in my simulation box. Now, this is going to be a number that is much, much smaller than the number of FFT points in my grid. Yeah. So we don't need so many eigenvectors. And even worse, the cost of doing a diagonalization scales cubically with the number of basis vectors I have. So, of grid points I have in my FFT grid. So this is of course this is completely horrible. Of course, I do a tremendous amount of work to get something I do not need, because we need only the NB lowest eigenstates of this Hamiltonian, where NB is of the order of the number of electrons per unit cell. So the perfect example of this would be to do a calculation on a small molecule in a very large box. So I have an enormous FFT grid, if you so want, and I need only very few, a very small amount of state. That would be the thing that drives this completely ad absurdum. So the solution to this is to use iterative matrix diagonalization. And iterative matrix diagonalization allows you to find the NB lowest eigenvectors of a Hamiltonian. So that is where this RMNDS, so residual minimization method through direct iteration of the iterative subspace, direct inversion of the iterative subspace, and this Bloch-Davidson method come in. So the key ingredients to iterative matrix diagonalization are subspace diagonalization and concept of the residual. So, the subspace, like I said, at every point of my calculation, I have a certain set of one electron functions. They're still being optimized and so on. But these functions that I have at that moment, they define a certain subspace. Well, if I have NB functions, I have a NB times NB subspace that I can diagonalize. So I can express my Hamiltonian in my subspace and have this overlap matrix, right? We have seen this. It's a generalized eigenvalue equation in the PRW method, like we saw. And I can solve this. And this. This is one of the key things that goes into this iterative matrix diagonalizations. Of course, I get then only approximate eigenvalues because I have only approximate eigenfunctions and so on. But these eigenstates are then the best approximation to the exact NB lowest eigenstates of my Hamiltonian defined by my current density within the subspace that I have. So that is shown here. So after the subspace diagonalization, I get the best approximation to my eigenfunctions within my current subspace. So the residual tells me the error due to the fact that there is also a gradient outside of the subspace, right? So the residual is defined in this way. So this will become, once I have exact eigenfunctions, these are exact eigenvalues, and then of course the residual becomes zero. So it's a norm for the measure in the error in the eigenvectors that I still have. Yeah. So how does, for instance, Bloch-Davidson work? That is iterative optimization. So I always mangle this explanation. So I will take a go at it again, and I hope that I do a better job of it than usual. But in Bloch-Davidson, we start by taking a subset of the bands, a block. So these are all my my orbitals. I have large n orbitals, and I now take a block of them, small n1. And so I will work on this block of orbitals first. So I will extend this this subset, this block, by adding the preconditioned residuals. So basically, a preconditioned residual. Well, here you see this is the residual of that particular orbital, and then it's preconditioned with a certain conditioning matrix. I will not go into that now, but that is what we do. But basically, what goes in is the residual on this block of orbitals. And so, and I extend my subspace. And so I had this block, and these are essentially the residuals of this block. And if this was a subspace of n1 times n1 functions, then now here I would have a subspace of 2n1 times 2n1 functions. Then I do a Rayleigh-Ritz optimization. So I do a diagonalization of this 2n1 times 2n1 subspace and take the n1 lowest eigenvectors of this after this diagonalization. And then I will extend my subspace again. So I had had my original block, then I had my residuals of this original block. Then I did all this work. And now I take these functions that I get out of all this work, these n1 lowest eigenvectors, calculate their residuals and add them to the subspace. Now I have a 3n1 times 3n1 subspace. And I do again an optimization, a diagonalization in the subspace, and so on and so forth. So with every time I do that, with every time I add these residuals and do a Rayleigh-Ritz diagonalization optimization, I increase my subspace by n1, and that makes it a Krylov method. So what I'm building is a Krylov space that belongs to this block of eigenfunctions. So, and the optimized, and I do this for a while, so for maybe three times up to a certain maximum, 1, 2, 3 times, maybe 4 times. And this block is maybe not so large. This might be a subset of 4 orbitals. So in the end, I have a 16 times 16 diagonalization to do. This Rayleigh-Ritz optimization is a diagonalization. So this is completely within scope. This is not something that that is a huge computational effort. And after I've done this a few times, I take these lowest n eigenvalues of the Rayleigh-Ritz optimization, and they will replace my original block. And then I go on to with the next block, so with the next subset, so n plus one and until and so on and so forth. So at the very end, there's one subspace diagonalization within the complete subspace. So that is a bit of an expensive step, but this n, of course, is our nb, right? So this is not nFFT. This is not the size of my FFT grid, but the number of bands that I definitely need to determine. So if you would do this, essentially, if you would increase your subspace further and further and further, and increase the dimension of your Krylov space, as it is called, these functions would be eigenfunctions of your Hamiltonian. With every time I do one of these steps, I approach and my functions become more like eigenfunctions of the Hamiltonian than they were before. So that is essentially how I iteratively get eigenfunctions, how I iteratively diagonalize my my Hamiltonian. So then we go to the second ingredient, and the second ingredient is charge density mixing. And charge density mixing, can follow the reasoning that is mapped out here, but we again start with a residual vector. Huh? So if I have a certain charge density and I do refinement and I compute a new density, so I get basically a new density as a function of the density that I've put in. Well, basically I want to reach a situation where this becomes zero, huh? Where the density that comes out of one such step is the same as what I have put in. Yeah. So we linearize this problem around the self-consistent density. Then one can write that in the following way, where this particular function J is a charge dielectric function. If we would know this function, then we could step essentially from our current row in, we could immediately step to the self-consistent density if we would know this charge dielectric function. The way I say it, you already feel it coming. We do not know it, but if we would know it, then the self-consistent density would be a simple function of our residual and the density that we have put in. Yeah, so we would compute our residual one time, and then basically this tells us, well, this would be the self-consistent density. Well, the problem is we do not know this charge dielectric function. So what we do is we use a clever mixing algorithm, this Broyden mixer, that basically as we iterate towards self-consistency, this mixer builds an approximation to this dielectric function. So from the behavior of our system as we are iterating, it learns the dielectric function. That's essentially what this mixer does. And the thing that we give it at the very start is an approximation to a model dielectric function, of which we say, well, in many, many cases, this is a good initial approximation for the dielectric function. And that is of this particular form. And these are, well, we have all defaults for all these parameters. This is a function, I should have written that more clearly, as a function of the reciprocal lattice vector. So a certain density component, let's say, at the reciprocal space lattice vector of, reciprocal basis vector of G of length one will be mixed in, that particular component of the residual will be mixed in with 0.2 in this particular approximation. Yeah, but that's only the initial approximation for the dielectric function. The mixer learns as it is iterating the density. The mixer learns a better approximation to the dielectric function. So that is how we accelerate convergence in the density mixer. So you will see these steps essentially in the following way. So if you look at this is a very typical OSCCAR file, which shows you information of what is happening as you are trying to approach the electronic ground state. So the first thing that we see is we see a few steps where there's nothing here, and there's nothing under RMSC. So this is these are iterations where the charge density is kept fixed at the density of the overlapping atomic charges, of the initial charge density, which in most cases is overlapping atomic charges. Why do we do that? We do that because we go in to this whole thing with trial wave functions as well that are essentially random numbers. So, and we do not refine them excessively. Yeah? So we do only a few steps of this whole play thingy with building the Kreloff subspace. So we build a Kreloff subspace that is maybe four levels deep. And so starting from random numbers, the wave functions after this first step, because each and every of these DAF steps here represents iterative refinement of the wave functions. So after this first step, the wave functions are still pretty bad. They are maybe better than random numbers, but still pretty bad. And you really do not want to mix in the density that they represent with whatever you started out with, which is in most cases atomic overlapping atomic charges. So we do several steps of iterative refinement without changing the density, and then at some point you say, okay, now we have also a reasonable approximation, we have reasonable wave functions as well, and then the density mixer kicks in and we start doing this, starting out from this model charge dielectric function, we start feeding the density that comes out after iterative refinement. We start feeding it into the mixer at every step, and it's learning this dielectric function, and hopefully, and in this case, well, it does, but hopefully it then converges to a point where the total energy doesn't change anymore, but also where, and that's what you see here, the root mean square change in the charge becomes very small. So this is the thing that you have to watch out for. When the mixer is happy and doing a good job, this has to continuously go down. So basically, it has to go down by an order of magnitude every few steps. If it's not, then the mixer might have troubles, and or there might be some other problem. So I have prepared one more slide. Don't know I'm set for time. I'm terribly fast again. I see. Okay. Well, I have one more slide prepared for you. And that is, so what do we do when the picture does not look like this? This is where we are very happy. But what do we do when we're not so happy? So let's say that we use the Davidson algorithm, which is the most robust solver that we have. What do we do when that fails to converge? So the first thing is that we want to make sure that it's we want to try to find out whether it's a problem with density mixer or some other problem. So we can set we can bypass the density mixer, and we set I charge to 12. That means that we do not update the charges ever. So we stick to a situation where we start out with atomic charges, and then keep them, and simply only iterate the wave functions until there's no change in the energy anymore. So when that fails to converge, then there's a serious problem. So if you, without updating the charge density, you're not able to converge your calculation, then there's a serious problem. Now, mostly, I say serious problem, but in 95% of those cases, that is because the structure that you have presented VASP with has some trouble. Very often that means a very strange choice of unit cell, something like that, or mostly it's simply atoms that sit too close together. So an initial structure that was not very well chosen. But when that has all been checked and has shown itself not be the problem, then if you end up in this branch, it's time to contact us through the support forum. So that is, and then we will try to look at it. Actually, the cases where this happens, they are this is very seldomly the case. So we are always very keen on getting them because we need those for our test sets and to improve upon things. It's very seldomly happens. Mostly when you fix the charge density, the calculation will converge. And that means that the mixer has some problem. And then you have to play with the mixing parameters. So there's some ways that a few steps proposed here. The first would be, so you set I charges two, which means you start from atomic charges, but you allow the charge density to be updated. So as opposed to here. But you generally decrease the amount of the new charge that is mixed into the old one. So if that converges, you can stick to that. If that fails to converge, then there's another possibility how to change this initial dielectric function that the mixer is presented with. That is written here. If that converges, well, you can try stick to that setting. Play with these parameters a bit. Try to find a good set. But if playing with the mixing parameters fails to converge completely, then we end up again in the same box. Mostly it will happen because of charge loss, mostly it will happen for metallic systems, and then again mostly for those that are large in some way or in some direction. So for instance, a slab calculation with a large vacuum, those will tend to be susceptible to charge loss, like I try to hand wavingly explain to you why this is a problem. One then has to try to get the mixer to converge it. But if that doesn't work at all, then it's also time to contact us through the forum. So Marie-Thérèse, I was again much too fast, I fear.
No, that was great, because now we have some time for Q&A, and I think yes. This was already a great introduction, but there are questions, so let's take them. First, you were talking about the K vector and also introduced the G vector actually in the first part of your lecture. Yes. Could you explain their physical meaning again and how to choose how many K points we need for the system?
Yeah, let's first go to maybe just to put them into some context. Yeah. So the K vectors, those were the ones that I said. I will try to keep this short, because the next speaker will have a lot more to say about this topic, and so there's another chance to ask questions on this. But essentially, what this shows you is that all the solutions that we can have from two R Cohn-Sham equations, they take on a very particular form. Yeah. And that form is essentially written here. Huh? So where we have the cell periodic part and we have a certain phase factor, where we now say, well, for this phase factor, there's certain choices. We can limit ourselves to a set of vectors that we have to consider. Yeah, here. So all possible solutions are essentially found by considering vectors that are part of this first Brio ensemble. So that still, very generally speaking, that is where this K vector comes in. So the G vector, if you so want, are the plane waves in which we expand this cell periodic part. And there are only certain vectors that they are not dissimilar to this K, of course, because this is also a plane wave. So, but to expand something that is cell periodic, there's only a certain set of vectors that you can choose, right? You have to choose something with a wavelength that fits in your cell. So there's only a certain set of vectors, these G vectors, that are the ones that are periodic with respect to the cell that we have chosen. So if we now put them into the same picture, that means the following. So I said, if I have this grid, so and this grid means that I said these are the smallest G vectors that I can take. And they are basically identical to the reciprocal space lattice vectors. Yeah. So the smallest distance in my reciprocal space grid are the reciprocal space lattice vectors. And so all points on this grid represent G vectors. Yeah. So if you would now ask, where are the K vectors in this? Well, the K vectors are the first Riemann zone of this. So they would fall into a little square here. So none of them would be larger than half the distance between one of these grid points. So what do they represent? They represent variations that of a wavelength larger than my unit cell. Okay, mm-hmm. So that's a bit, shows you a bit the relation or the difference between K vectors and G vectors, if you so want. So how many K vectors do you need to choose? Well, that depends on the method that you use to sample your first Brillouin zone with. It depends on properties of the material. I'm sure that Martin will have a lot to say about it, but generally speaking, you want to get an evenly spaced mesh. So I don't want to sample, for instance, this square is the first Brillouin zone of a simple cubic lattice, simple cubic two-dimensional lattice. So I do not want to sample this more densely in one direction than in the other. Now, as my real space crystalline lattice cell becomes larger in a certain direction, this reciprocal space vector will become smaller. Yeah. So when I have a cell that is much smaller in this direction, I don't want as many points along this direction as I have along that direction. So basically, it follows from the fact that you want to get a uniform dense sampling of your reciprocal space, that you choose to have more points along a certain direction than along another direction. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure that Martin will have a lot more to say about that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so, as you said, it's system dependent, and basically one needs to do a convergence study for the particular property.
Yes.
One wants to look at.
Yeah. So one has to check. One has to check whether the thing that one is interested in is, again, whether it's converged with respect to sampling, gate point sampling density. Yeah, that is true. Yeah.
So let's go jump back to density mixing. Is that also possible in direct minimization? Could that appear?
Yes, it can and it does. So let me go here. Let me go here. So unfortunately, I don't think I have a slide on it here. But there are cases where one would like to use a direct minimization algorithm. And those cases are mostly when one is using orbital dependent functional. So if we have, for instance, hybrid functionals, where the Hamiltonian is not completely, or the total energy is not completely determined by the density, but it has an orbital dependent part, in those cases, sometimes density mixing is not the best choice one can make. Because the mixer only learns about the system from the changes it sees in the density. And if density does not carry all the information, for instance, in hybrid functionals where there's an orbital dependency, then it might not be the best way to treat your electronic problem. So for that, we actually have a few algorithms implemented that essentially do conjugate gradient using a direct minimization. But of course, there you still run into the trouble that you can have charge sloshing. So what is done there is that basically this part of the gradient is simply followed, if you so want, in a conjugate gradient sense or whatever algorithm one chooses. But this part, this part is prone to induce charge sloshing. For this, we find an optimal subspace rotation by means of density mixing. So there's an additional loop inside where density mixing again is used to suppress charge sloshing. Yeah. So it is possible, yes.
One or two important parameters to adjust for density mixing would be A mix and B mix. Could you elaborate on how far one could go with these parameters? What is a sensible
setting? I think that these are pretty these suggestions that are made here, they are I'm not saying that this is exhaustive, of course. These are two settings, but what you see here is changing B mix from 1 to 3 supposedly does quite a bit. Yeah. So don't make it 30 or something like that. So it's of this order, the changes that one is looking at. Like with A mix, A mix is a very general thing that carries this. So basically, you would suppress this whole curve, if you so want, by reducing A mix. Reducing A min, for instance, sets a hard limit on how much of the small components are mixed in. A small wave vector components of the change in the charge density. Those are exactly the slowly varying changes in the charge density that induce large contributions in the change in the potential. So what happens here is very very important for suppressing charge sloshing. So the fact that we suppress low frequency components is essentially completely for this. So yeah.
In this slide, actually, could you add what is the value of A mix when you increase B mix? So here in this increase B mix, we have B mix 3, A mix 0.01.
Yes, so I would leave it at 0.01. Right? Well, I would leave it even at 0.01. Because it already failed to converge there. But to be honest, I would have to ask the originator of this graph whether it was completely intended to inherit everything that was in the box before. I'd say one has to play with these parameters more than is shown here. Yeah. So it is not a matter of trying these two settings and then contacting support. That is not how this is meant to to be taken.
Great. So then you have shown a slide of the typical OSCCAR file. And you discussed the column about the charge density and the density mixing. Could you also comment on the other columns, what they are?
Yes. So the first of, okay, this is total energy, right? Iteration number, the total energy, then the change in the total energy with respect to the previous step, I hope that it should be. This is the change in the eigenvalues. This is the number of times that H psi was evaluated. So that tells you something about how much effort was spent in iterative optimization, because this is not always the same amount. And so how deeply one goes into this tree, now there's a maximum, of course, but there's also conditions that tell you, okay, I only, for this set of orbitals, I only create a one-dimensional Krylov subspace. For another set, I might create a two-dimensional one because they're still far away from being optimal. So that's basically what you see here. How often H psi was. So this is the root mean square change in the orbitals, but this is by far the most instructive if you want to look at whether your calculation is doing a good thing, and that is the change.
How do
in
you
the charge
judge? Sorry, I can. Yeah. Can you repeat so I don't overlap?
Yeah. So this is the root mean square change in the charge density from one step of the mixer to the next. So this is the most indicative one. This tells you whether your mixer is in trouble or not.
Where do you see whether this calculation is converged? So please go ahead.
Well, essentially, you will see that when this continuously goes down and this reaches your threshold, you set a threshold on the total energy and you say, well, that step from one step to the other, it is below this and that, then I say I'm there. Yeah. But that can be deceptive, because you might, if when your mixer is in a whole lot of trouble and this is not going down, so there's changes in the density all the time, you might by chance make a very small step in terms of total energy. When you then say, super, I'm there, then that is not true. So to have the change in the total energy to be meaningful, you have to be essentially on an exponentially converging curve, because otherwise I could say, well, I make a step here of a milli electron volt. It's too large, but okay, tenth of a milli electron volt. I say I'm converged, but what would be when following it would be 10,000 steps of the same size? Then I would, of course, still be facing a huge change in the total energy. So only if this is exponentially converging, so I can be sure that the next step will be smaller, and the next one will be even smaller, and the next one will be even smaller, so that it cannot accumulate to anything that is appreciable, only then does this criterion in the total energy mean anything. And that you can basically best see from what is happening in your charge density.
Mm-hmm. And this charge sloshing, can that also happen if you have a finite gap? Even so, the gap is very small, but it's finite. Are you still in danger?
Yeah. Yes. Because you will always, maybe not always, but you are well advised to always have a number of unoccupied states as well. This will speed up convergence. Yeah, normally it will speed up convergence, but it carries, of course, it's essentially the mixing of states just above and with states just below the Fermi energy in this subspace rotation part of the gradient that leads to charge sloshing. So. Yes, you can have this. If there will be a certain amount of that, even if you have a gap, but it will be worse when the gap is small.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So switching gears a little bit, we have now talked about the charge density, but if the system is magnetic, then of course we are talking about the spin density. And what happens there? How can I influence the convergence of a magnetic system?
Yeah, so by far, and really by far, the most important thing with respect to convergence of magnetic calculations is to specify a reasonable initial magnetic system. This is important for many, many reasons. Not in the least for the fact that that whatever you specify for, and maybe Martin will also talk about this in his talk, the symmetry operations that the program deduces and says, okay, they are consistent with the system that I'm looking at, that will look at this, at what you specify for the initial magnetic moments. It will not look at, it will not analyze the density of a previous calculation even. Yeah? It will look at what you have put into your INCA file for MACMOM and it say, okay, this and that symmetry operation is relevant. This and that needs to go out. It's incompatible with the system I should be looking at. And this can have a huge impact. This can, of course, be this can be the change between a ferromagnet, between finding a ferromagnet or finding an antiferromagnet, if that is the ground state, and so on and so forth. So that is by far the most important. If you are an unfortunate person, then you are dealing with non-collinear magnetic systems, then there is often the case that the mixer has trouble. So the mixer sees, it's building this dielectric function, but that will be very strongly dominated by the strongest response of the system at the beginning, if you so want. So you give it this model, and then it starts to learn. And what will it learn? It will learn electrostatics. It will not see the changes in the magnetization so strongly, because they don't affect the total energy so strongly. So it will build a function that is very well tuned to optimize certain degrees of freedom and not so well tuned to optimize others. Yeah, and these others in this case are especially in non-collinear magnetic systems are the magnetic modes. They often are much, much softer. So slight variations of the magnetic moments will not affect the total energy so strongly as moving an electron from one side to the other. Yeah, it is simply a completely different scale. And then the mixer can run into trouble. And then it might be a good idea again to use a direct optimizer, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Great. I hope that answered the questions from the audience. And there are just a couple more we can hopefully get in these 2 minutes. If the PAW pseudo potentials are so accurate in your experience, are there ever situations where all electron calculations are needed?
Well, I would like to say no, but of course we really rely on them in terms of benchmarks as well. And there are cases where there are some differences between what you get out of a PAW calculation and an all electron calculation. So what comes to mind the most? Well, in principle, it should not be necessary. What comes to mind the most is possibly, well, in our case, possibly for spin orbit coupling, there might be differences between an all electron calculation and a PAW calculation. But in that case, mostly due to the,
What about
quark? No, there's not a, sorry. Yeah, due to the way we treat quark state. So because that is maybe one point to be made here. Yeah. An all-electron calculation does not mean we take into account all electrons, right? You can still have core electrons and valence electrons. So in those cases, where we're not talking about unfreezing or unfreezing the core and treating them on the same footing as the valence, if we're not talking about that, then it should not be necessary to go to an all electron picture. All electron in that picture means including these nodal features. So there are some limitations to the way we construct BAW potentials that have some effect in terms of in spin orbit coupling, in the way spin orbit coupling acts. But that is not a principal problem of the BAW method. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That is an aspect of how we have implemented it.
I think that was actually a great closing, and I would like to stop the official part here and thank you for these two great talks and this introduction into the PAW method.
Very welcome.